So what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. We've all heard that. We've probably even said it. And obviously it refers to the hijinks and craziness that can happen when one goes to Vegas and takes part in all the festivities in that great city. But here's the challenge and the reason I bring that up. So often that same what happens in Vegas mentality gets applied to strategic planning. And let me tell you what I mean by that. How often at your place of business has your executive, or perhaps you as the executive, gone away on a retreat with some other key members of the management team? Maybe it's been at some fancy resort. Maybe it's been in Vegas. You were out there doing your strategic planning and you come back and mum's the word. We don't know what really happened in Vegas because no one ever saw the strategic plan that you were working on. That's a challenge. When you think about it, the only way that we can get things done in business is through people. And so if people are going to impact our business and drive our business results, and the strategic plan is all about setting the path for achieving our business results, it would only make sense that we have to reveal what's in those strategic plans to our people. Now here's the key. Not only do we have to communicate it out, but we've got to communicate it out in a way that our people can grasp. In other words, our frontline widget makers have to understand perhaps how many widgets they need to make or what defect rate they have to get to in order to make us more money. Our sales team perhaps has to know what market share we're going after or what new markets we're going after and why. So you get my drift there. I had an organization once that probably over-communicated their business numbers. The challenge was that they were German-owned. And every time the plant manager here in the States got up to talk, and she talked in revenue numbers, she talked in terms of euros. Now, I don't know about you, I don't know the going rate, exchange rate for currency on any given day, and neither did the employees of this plant. And so all the effort that organization put into communicating fell short because it wasn't in terms that the employees could grasp. In this case, euros instead of dollars. But let's go back to that idea of strategic planning. There's an old saying that culture eats strategy for lunch. And I don't necessarily disagree with that. However, if we don't have a strategy, our culture is going to develop in any way, shape, or form that it wants to. Our strategy can actually help us to form our culture. Here's what I mean. There are generally three accepted types of business strategies out there. The first one is customer intimacy. So an organization that focuses on customer intimacy is one that decides that it will develop such a relationship with its customers that its customers may be willing to even pay them more for the experience. So think about Nordstrom. Why do people shop there when they can get clothing that perhaps would be more value priced at another store? Because of the service they get from the sales staff there. Some would argue it's Starbucks and how they call people by name and how they write your name down and write little things on the cups and the mugs. Either way, we're talking about organizations that value the customer and drive their business through that relationship. Zappos Marketing, the online retailer, also comes to mind. Oftentimes people will say it's Southwest and how they treat their people. Maybe you have some come to mind to you right now, folks that maybe local folks that you deal with, and you go there simply because of that relationship. Well, if that's our business strategy, we need to communicate that out to our people. And no, it's not that the customer is always right or the customer's number one or those other silly sayings. I'm talking about how do we develop a true relationship with our customers, and do our employees know that that's our business strategy, why that's our business strategy, and how they have to implement it. The second main type of business strategy is product or service leadership. And that typically means that an organization is going to put out the best product, the best service that money can buy. And again, people might be willing to pay more because that product or that service is so much better than the competition. So the one that comes to mind is Apple. You can go out and buy the latest iPhone for a significant amount of money, or you can go buy a Droid version for usually much less, maybe not have all the bells and whistles. But see, that's where Apple is headed. It wants the latest and greatest products out there, and people will pay extra for those products. Heck, all you have to do is go to your local mall where the Apple store is, and you'll see how many hundreds of people are in the Apple store, even in the middle of a workday. So it's working for Apple. Again, think about maybe a local retailer that you love their coffee, you love their sandwiches, whatever it might be, and you support them above all else because of that quality product. So again, an organization that is going to be focused on product or service leadership needs to communicate that out to their employees. Whenever we start to go down a path of strategy that does not overtly put the customer first, our employees may question it. We just need to be prepared to explain that it's not that we're not putting our customer first, we just know that we're taking care of our customer if we in fact put the best possible product on the market. Now, the final type of strategic planning for a business is operational excellence. This type of organization focuses on its internal processes and makes them run the tightest ship possible. So think a logistics company like a UPS or a FedEx. Even Walmart has some great logistical capabilities which allows them to keep their cost of goods down. And so these clients build their relationships with their customers through that operational excellence, making everything they do run smoothly, run tightly, and they can drive their value to their clients and their customers that way. And so again, oftentimes when employees look at that type of environment, they feel like it's too inwardly focused. And so we have to educate them to help them to see why we're so inwardly focused and why that inward focus ultimately benefits our customers. And so why do I start off today talking about those three types of strategic planning? Well, that's because everything in our business starts with that strategic plan. Out of that comes two things. The biggest is our business culture. Once we know the type of strategy that our business is going to entail, now we can build everything else around that, and we can start to shape our culture around that type of an environment. Again, think of all the trendy organizations out there, like a Google, and the kinds of environments that they're creating for their employees. They're creating that culture because they want the innovation out of their employees. So we have to think about what kind of culture we're trying to drive that's going to support that business strategy. The second thing that comes out of the business strategy is our HR strategy. And that, of course, entails everything related to our employees, from how we recruit someone on the front end to how we hire them and promote them and train them and pay and reward them to perhaps even how we offboard them. And so when I think about how the HR strategy and how the business culture can shape the business, I look at it in terms of our total rewards package. How do those two things support how we pay our people through their base comp package? How do we incent them? How do we reward their performance and manage that performance? How do we train and develop them to be the best people they can be? And then how do we make all of that fit with the work-life concerns that they have? And yes, you heard me say work-life fit. It's not about work-life balance. Work-life balance means that we're working just as much as we're playing, and who wants to do that? It's about what's going to work for a given person at a given point in their career and in their personal situation, and that's going to change. So those things encompass our total rewards. Again, it's compensation, it's benefits, it's our bonus structures, it's our training and development and our performance management and our work-life fit. All of those combine to make the total package for our employees. If we get that system correct, and there is no right or wrong way to get that system correct, it's predicated based upon our HR strategy and that business culture. If we get that correct, that leads to attracting great employees, retaining them, and motivating them. And you see, that's where the magic happens. People throw those words out, attract, motivate, and retain, all the time. But that's really where the magic happens, because if we do that, we get the best possible performance out of our employees. Guess where that leads? The best possible organizational performance that we could have. So I started out talking about what stays in Vegas should stay in Vegas, or what happens in Vegas should stay in Vegas. But when it comes to our business and our strategic planning, what happens at the strategic planning meeting shouldn't stay at the strategic planning meeting. It needs to come back. That binder needs to be a working document. I have to laugh when I ask my clients to see their strategic plans and they get me a binder and I open it up and it creaks and cracks and it's dusty because it hasn't been opened in 2 years. That's crazy to me. That document should be driving every business decision. That document should be out in every executive meeting. If we're having employee focus groups or town hall meetings, we should be referencing that document. It's the lifeblood of our organization. You probably paid someone significant dollars to help you facilitate that. So get the thing out and use it. But most of all, communicate it out to your people. Communicate out to them why you've got the plan that you have and what their role is going to be in helping you to implement that. If you need help with that communication process and getting your people on board, give me a ring.